Every animal within its system has an inbuilt mechanism to deal with stress. And when the stress becomes chronic or over time, the system of the being starts to alter consistently and continuously so that it can deal with the stress that's happening in the environment outside. And I believe that within us is a very strong survival instinct. And this survival instinct can trigger and bring out sort of latent capabilities which we never knew existed just because of the stress. I believe we have early warning systems which we normally do not listen to. We have checks and balances within our system which keeps telling us that something is on. And I believe that we are capable of a lot more than we give credit for. In my own personal experience, the first time a latent capability kind of came out as an early warning system happened when I stood there hugging this person and saying, something smells different. Now, different is putting it very lightly because what I was about to experience in the next few months was catastrophic. And I would say that I experienced a level of stress which is similar to what infantry soldiers experienced in World War I. And I can say that with accuracy because the symptoms I exhibited were called things like trench mouth, which happened in the trench warfare, or things like PTSD, all the things that kind of said that my system, even though it was not being bombarded with actual bombs or mines, my system was reacting as though it was. And within that levels of stress, that mud of the stress, a lotus started to blossom. In yoga, we believe that without the mud, there is no lotus. And if there is a lotus, there is a mud. And that lotus was the practice of yoga. And a lot of things that triggered with the practice as well as stress. So when I stand here in front of you, it is to tell you that your stress can be your purpose. Okay, can lead you to your purpose. Now, as I started to, you know, go further in my life, you know, a few months later on, I started going into this healing journey. And that's when one day my nose decided to take me somewhere which I needed to know and I had no idea of. So I was walking down the street and I stopped by a store which is selling essential oils. And I walk into the store and I'm like a kid in a candy store, just that I've never had this candy before. And I go in and I ask this lady, can you help me? I had no idea what help I needed. And this beautiful radiant woman there, she starts helping me with various fragrances. And because of my practice, my body had become very sensitive and very aware, and I was really, really enjoying the fragrances. And trust me, it is very different from the artificial scent that you're smelling right now in the room. It was something that was so soothing, and it was talking to me in many, many ways. And at one point, I remember just holding on to a vial and just smelling it in, and I was saying, is that rose? And she said, yeah. I mean, it was like, yeah, it's rose. I mean, what do you mean? Now, what happened to me at that moment was, as I took those fragrances in, it felt like I was wearing this really tight blouse, which I did not even know existed in my chest. And somehow this fragrance just unhooked me and I was breathing for the first time. I felt light, I felt alive, and I felt as though I had this sense of release which I did not have despite months of practice and, you know, lots of, you know, things that was being done to me as well as doing by myself to help me heal. And this was the moment where I went, I hope you kind of got a bit of an idea of what it means to just go, Again, I smelled the fragrance and I had tears streaming down my eyes. It was not the sad tears that I was used to. It was suddenly these happy tears. And I instinctively knew I needed to smell something else. So I asked her to give me some other essences and I paused at a basil and a bergamot. These are oils I've never smelled before. And I asked her, can I blend these? Can I mix these? Very naively, and she said, of course. And I mixed these up, got a couple of vials, and off I went. And these oils became part of my practice, part of my teaching, so much so that back in Hong Kong, my students would say that they can smell their way into the classroom that I'm teaching at. And it was not just, you know, just these little things of people being able to smell, but I also started observing interesting changes. The one that really got me thinking was there was a day when a dear colleague of mine, she was going through a pretty, you know, difficult day. She was going through something that was intensely, when she was going through intense grief. And there was a critical deadline and, you know, she had tears streaming down her eyes and still she was working. And that's when I was like, okay, maybe this oil that worked for me so well might work for her. So I give it to her. And this is what I observed. She would sit there smelling, and while she's smelling, she's working peacefully. And then the moment she steps off, she keeps the oil back and, you know, she walks away. And she would come back, you know, and the grief has kind of overpowered her. So I realized that, you know, maybe if she sits there smelling these oils, it works wonders. So now that's the part, that's the Zuzu part, that as I kind of, you know, call it. The Zuzu part is all the experiences that I have and the experiences that I observe, which I don't think the Western science has been able to explain. But when I look at it from an Eastern perspective, because the Eastern perspective was more internal, it kind of went more into the senses, there were answers to it. So I always like to kind of see what is the experience, what is it that you really feel. And then comes the part where I go completely into science, where I'm really cynical and I want to know why did that happen and how did that happen. And I also want to know answers to what ifs and why nots, and then start working with it, because that's how I've been trained all my life. So this is where things get more interesting. So I start reading up more about the oils, and I come to know that the rose oil, as well as chocolates, has something that is so similar to what you create when you are in love. So when you're smelling that oil, you're actually creating that love. And when you smell basil, it's got things like, that's very similar to estrogen. It's got things that helps you release the pain. It's analgesic in nature. So what happens is that the pain releases and the bergamot starts to really help you open up because of its very strong scent. So that there came the science part of it. And I started getting more excited about it and started blending more things. So this one, I very lovingly call it the ultimate heartbreak cure. Because if you smell it, you must be having a heartbreak and you feel just fine. And when I say heartbreak, it doesn't really mean that it has to be an emotional heartbreak or a relationship break. It can also be when you put your heart into work and it doesn't really work out. The grief that you feel, how can you deal with it? And that's where this beautiful fragrances started to work for me. And things started getting funny and naughty from there, because I started blending things for hormones, how to keep my hormones moving beautifully, how to keep it regulated. I even tried funny, interesting things like love potions, where, you know, you have create a particular fragrance for a man, a particular fragrance for a woman, and then mix it up, and then suddenly there is a real sensation of being in love. There is a compulsive desire to be with that other person. So these were things that were very, very exciting for me, because from experience I could see, and yet from the science part of it, I couldn't really, really explain what was going on. And that's when things got really blessed, because I managed to meet people who are into perfumery and they could tell me how exactly it works. So from the Zuzu part, now I invite you to the science part of it. Olfaction, the process with which you take in, you know, scents, fragrances through your nose, and the sensory inputs go directly into your brain, and it goes to the part, the limbic brain. That is the primordial part of your brain. That's where the emotions, the memories are stored. And scent, unlike other senses, the perfumes, unlike other senses, can trigger emotional memories and, you know, things that can be all the way from your childhood. So suddenly when you smell something, you get transported all the way back to your grandmother's house in the evening at the garden, and you are smelling what she was making at tea time. You know, there are specific scents to everything. And if we can kind of work with those scents, you can actually trigger emotions. And you can actually trigger memories, which can be quite helpful in healing or transforming a person. Now, there is the other part of it, because what makes these essential oils, you know, have that aroma? Now, there is studies that says that it is actually these compounds have a particular way of electron transference, and that is what goes into our senses. So it goes all the way into subatomic particles. But then if I go a bit further, all these oils are made of many, many compounds. And these compounds, by the very nature, coming from, you know, plants, coming from trees, these have the ability to mimic certain biochemical reactions in the body, biochemical functions in the body. So for instance, like I said a bit earlier, like, you know, basil can do something similar to estrogen. Likewise, rose can do something similar to the biochemistry of love. So we suddenly have what is a science behind it as well. So then you can kind of start working on how do you create blends which helps you with specific conditions. And that's where things get a bit zuzu, a bit science for me, because I realized when I worked with, you know, very good perfumers, that there was a very unique way that I felt the perfumes in my body. It was not just the emotions or the memories that it triggered, but it actually had a response in my physical body. Now, if I go into Eastern science, we speak about in terms of chakras. And I would say, like, you know, take the mysticism away, start thinking of chakras or any of those terms as points within your body where you start having sensations. You can't really, you know, what's it, pinpoint where the sensation is, but you can say that maybe it's at the back of your spine, or it's in your abdomen, it's in your chest, whichever that is. So started working with that. So if you ever come to our lab, you would find a table, and it's kind of marked according to the body. Okay, you will have all the way to the tailbone, which we call the Muladhara Chakra, and all the way to the crown. And then I start working with the sense. Now the interesting part is I really do not need to know what the oil is. Okay, so I may not have any idea what the oil is when I'm smelling it, but I try to see how does it affect my body, and then kind of place it, where does it affect? Does it activate that particular part? Does it energize that particular part? Does it calm that particular part? Does it relax that particular part? Or does it regulate? So based on this, I go grading it. So there is a proper calibration that happens. And then comes a part where you start thinking of, okay, let's work with, say, hormonal irregularities. Now, why does a woman have a hormonal irregularity? It could be because she's stressed. So then can I work with her stress? So I take the oils which helps work with the stress. Can I work at the part where she actually has a physical hormonal imbalance? So then I might start working with jasmine, so that, you know, one part of jasmine which would work with progesterone, the other part of jasmine which would work with estrogen, and start blending from there. Or maybe she's got something going on with her thyroid, so then can I work with that? Or maybe she's not feeling confident enough, and which in turn has affected her entire body, so can I work with that? So start working with all these possible causes and kind of come out with a blend which I, you know, currently call it as healing perfumery, because it smells amazing but has a deep impact on you. Now this is where it gets very interesting, because I work with women, so I understand a woman's body. Now interestingly, when I make my colleague smell it, you know, he smells it and says that, you know, this is quite attractive because it actually mimics the scent of a woman who is healthy. So for a man, it becomes very attractive. So can we start using the same scent both to kind of, you know, make a woman feel more regulated, more, you know, in peace, more in clarity, and the same scent can work for men to get attracted to women as well. So all these oils that you blend start having deeper and deeper impacts. You know, your body will constantly tell you what it needs. You just have to become sensitive to what it needs and work along with it. And then it starts to really, really open up. And as I draw to a close, I want to leave you with one thought. You know, yoga teaches me that if we take absolute responsibility of our thoughts, of our words, of our actions, we no longer stay puppets to fate, because within our system, we believe in fate and fatalities and destiny. But yoga teaches us that the moment you take responsibility, you start creating the destiny that you want to see. You start creating the change that you want to see. You start connecting to the purpose of your life. You start connecting with yourself. You meet yourself. And when that happens, and my sincere prayer is that it happens to all of us who are here, you know, and when that happens, you become the perfume, a perfume far greater than what you're holding right now. And then that perfume really starts to, you know, blossom and come out into the planet. The ones who are really, really needed, the ones who are attracted by that scent, the right ones will come to you. And together, you'll all be healthier and happier. Namaste.